got inside of us. And sort of talk a little bit about the connection of our bodies and ourselves with the universe. And so in order to do that, so we're switching scales quite a bit, obviously from the city going to the universe, I guess this one, okay. Let me ask, who's been to the Southern Hemisphere? Great, did you see these fuzzy things? Anybody? No? Okay, so small Magellanic Cloud, large Magellanic Cloud. That's the band of our own Milky Way galaxy. And the crazy thing about these objects, these hazy little smudges, these are galaxies orbiting within our own galaxy. Okay, so the Large Magellanic Cloud has about a billion stars in it. I'll show you a few close-ups of this one. It's been a remarkable story over the last couple of decades. We've started finding more and more galaxies inside of our own galaxy. And we have to rethink, actually, what do we even call a galaxy, because we found some now that only have a few hundred stars in them. So wonderful story there. Can't quite get to this one. But let's look a little bit closer what this Large Magellanic Cloud looks like. So we see all the stars in here. It's a great picture because it comes with all the names already. So it's great for a theorist, I get to look up what's what. But the part I want to show you is, this is what we see in the visible. That's what our eyes could see, so the optical is mostly stars like our sun, just so many of them that multiple of them fall within one pixel of each picture, and it looks milky and hazy. We don't resolve all the individual stars themselves. But the remarkable thing is, when you think about galaxies that way, there's just a collection of, enormous collection of stars. In that sense, a galaxy is completely empty. So we can throw two galaxies at each other, which the universe is actually doing for us. Andromeda galaxy, our sister galaxy, is just a little bit bigger than the Milky Way. We're speeding towards each other, 300 kilometers a second, a few billion years, we're going to make one galaxy. It will be a great time for astronomy. 5 billion years from now, many stars right here. But in this event, where we have hundreds of billions of stars rushing towards each other from both sides, not one star, not two stars will hit. They're completely empty. Not surprising, our sun is quite small, the next star is a few light years away. Yeah, it's mostly space. On the other hand, the beauty with our technology and the instrumentation we have is that we have multiple views of the galaxy. And here just show a very narrow band images that just shows the hydrogen and some sodium glow in this Large Magellanic Cloud. And you already get the sense that there is more to it than just these points of light. These are gases that have been lit up by massive stars, radiation traveling out, heating up the gas, warming it up. If I go to longer wavelength, this is now in the mid-infrared by the Spitzer Space Telescope, you see how the whole space fills in. So this gas, there's a whole bunch of component of gas that's between the stars, which we call the interstellar medium. If we go to even longer wavelengths, then we see colder things yet. And this is cold dust now, shown by the Herschel Space Telescope, and it's just full. And this gas gets sculpted by all the actions of what massive stars are doing. We have stars exploding, supernovae, where entire parts of stars are rushing out at 10,000 kilometers a second and sweeping up the material that they find. We have radiation coming out of these stars that heats the material and provides extra pressure, shaping this interstellar medium. And at the same time, there's other places where gravity gets a hold of these gas clouds and it starts collapsing them back together and making new stars. So our own Milky Way galaxy makes about 3 stars a year. Keeps going. It's a very dynamic place, the universe, in particular once we focus on the right timescales. Let me give you another quick example that's nearby, aptly named the California Nebula. There's one particular star in here that is 330,000. It's 330,000 times as bright as the sun. One single star, okay? It's 40 times as heavy as the sun. You can imagine it's doing something totally crazy. I mean, it's running through its energy budget extremely fast. If you're 300,000 times brighter than the sun, you're gonna get the energy from somewhere. And so what it's doing, obviously, is to have all this nuclear fusion going on in its very center and producing a huge amount of energy that it will die young, right? It will run out of fuel because it's going so rapidly through its fuel. So as a consequence, some of these stars can live just 1,000 times shorter than our sun. Okay, it's 40 times heavier, so it'll only live maybe 10 million years instead of the 10 billion that we're fortunate to have for our sun. Let me just see that. Astronomers are not always good at naming things. Here, so I've looked out of here. Over here. Okay. Now, in just this journey where I'm trying to get us out of, think about larger scale, I wanted to show you just this animation really quick. It's not big quite enough. You already noticed that was the Orion constellation, and we started flying towards it. It's already all misshapen. Right? Constellations are these chance projections on the sky. Once you go towards them, you recognize, oh, some of these stars are much closer, others are really bright but far away. And as you keep going, and we're going at some crazy speed. Okay, so this is 1,500 light years away, and we just made it in a few seconds. Orion Nebula, there's the Oortzeit Nebula over here. All these gases, again, lit up by the massive stars deep inside the clouds, making this hydrogen gas glow. The amazing thing about this movie is the color, the position, the brightness of every single star is absolutely correct. These are all measured things. We're flying here by the Rosette Nebula. 10,000 new stars have been formed in this region, including a few massive ones, again, lighting up the Oort cloud. Here we're coming by another object that at first glance looks similar. Let's see, do you see something blinking inside? Maybe a little bit, something flashing. That's a Crab Nebula. That's actually the remnant of one massive star that exploded. We slowed this down a little bit. In reality, there's a neutron star about the size of Palo Alto that's spinning around its own axis 30 times a second. So that's, you know, it's very rather crazy what neutron stars would do. Think about it, the whole city going around itself 30 times a second. Okay, so that was the one thing we made up. We have no idea what the Milky Way looks like from top. Okay. We have a rough idea where the spiral arms are. But what do you notice? All the dots now are actually galaxies. And they don't just hang out in random places. That's our friend Andromeda that we're heading towards to, the Triangulum Galaxy, which has a beautiful, massive star-forming region that we're just flying through right here. But what do you notice already? All these single dots now are actually galaxies, and they align more in filaments and sheets, and they make some round balls, which we'll see one, which we call galaxy clusters. That's the Virgo cluster of galaxies. Again, we measured all the positions and put all the right images in the right places. The only thing we had to do is we made the galaxies a few times bigger than they really are. Otherwise, it's really hard to see. There's so much empty space between the galaxies. But again, the filamentary structures, and here, about 2% of all the galaxies in the universe hang out in these structures called clusters of galaxies, where you have thousands of galaxies go around each other. to a cosmologist, this is purely our backyard. This is super close. You know, many of us are just not interested in things that close. Universe is much, much bigger than this place, but we learned so much about the individual shapes of galaxies. There's one very special one here called M87, and you see a little thing sticking out? There's actually a black hole in the very center of this galaxy, 3 billion times the mass of our sun. 3 billion times, one black hole. It's spewing out material and very close to the speed of light, and those are these funny checks that we saw sticking out. And they can go from millions of light years in distance. Marvelous things that we have really hard time to think about and to think through how that works. But for me, the beginning really was, learning about that the universe is an age. So 13.8 billion years ago, that's what we had in the universe. And we already saw all this rich structure, all the thing that sort of surrounds us now. How did that all get here? Like, yeah, what I would had such a hard time is, I wish I would have thought of that question earlier. Is what was the very first thing in the universe? I mean, if it had sort of a beginning, well, what was the first thing that formed? And that sort of, you know, for 15 years of my life became sort of an obsession. And there is one crucial piece of information that we have with radiation that we can see left over from the Big Bang. So that's really radiation that was around right from the very earliest few seconds that as the universe was small and really hot, we had all this radiation travel around, but it couldn't get out. It wasn't going on straight lines, it was just bouncing off everything around it, mostly electrons actually. And so this radiation is bouncing around, it's like being in a cloud. You can't get anywhere. You keep getting scattered around. But as the universe expanded and cooled down, there came a point in the universe history where all of a sudden, these bits of radiation, these photons, had their last interaction. And from here on out, they kept going in straight lines. For 13.8 billion years now, they've been traveling towards us, and all we have to do is put detectors in front of them to actually record information of what the universe was like directly when it was about 400,000 years old. And this is a wonderful thing for us because it provides really, if you think about it, a direct image of what the initial conditions were, of how the universe got started. And it takes a while to explain this whole image. Let me just say that we have cold and hot spots, but we really studied it in extreme detail. So these are fluctuations of one part in 100,000. So the red one is one part in 100,000 warmer than the blue part. Okay, so tiny, tiny variations. So for most purposes, you can really think of the universe having started out as extremely uniform. Very slight variations from place to place. But they are the crucial ones. Because now you can imagine if you have a place that's a little bit denser than the rest of the universe, gravity will start working on it. And so even though everything's flying apart and we're expanding, the ones that's denser, that's feeling its own gravity, starts expanding slightly slower than the rest. And that's the thing, never pick a fight with gravity. Right? It's always good advice, it always wins. And in fact, it provides and powers everything that's around us. Right? The sun's energy is ultimately coming from gravity. Right? It holds that thing together, and yes, we're turning some matter into energy through nuclear fusion, but fundamentally, it gained all this energy to become this hot because gravity squeezed it. And so stars, you know, they end up as neutron stars and black holes, mostly because of this, because they picked a fight with gravity, and they always lose on this one. And yeah, so we get a tremendous amount of information out of these maps. We can see, you know, because the universe was such a simple place back then, we've learned tremendous amounts of what it's made of, what are the constituents, and it was a very simple place. It left us with many puzzles. There's a huge amount of matter we just don't quite understand, don't know exactly what it is, that we just call dark matter. We know it doesn't scatter with light, it doesn't absorb any light, but we see it everywhere. The evidence is just overwhelming. Just the speeds of how galaxies go around each other, how fast stars go inside galaxies, all these things tell us about that. But for the purposes of today, I just think of this as a physicist, this is an amazing homework problem. Here is an initial state of matter, in all the universe. If you're a good physicist, you should know all the laws of physics and just work out what comes next. Right? How hard can it be? Sort of the thing, but you know, that's kind of what it is. I mean, we know gravity, we know how fast the universe is expanding, we know it was made of gas, it was a hydrogen helium gas. Often, we know the chemistry that would happen in gas like this, so that whole fluid behavior, well, we have to study that all the time. When we want to think about the weather, we want to think about engineering applications, we're constantly thinking about how do fluids behave. And so we spend a lot of time on that, putting it all together, of all these different processes, the gravity, the fluids, the chemistry, the mixing, radiation. we'll have a hard time to do it on a piece of paper, but if we use a big computer, we can actually program all these laws, map them onto the algorithm or resolve the equations, and we already know what initial state to start with. That's provided by the observations. So we should be able to work that out. I just love this video. I should try to simulate this, actually. But it just gives you sort of that interaction of gravity, the falling, the how the fluid shapes here, the mixing, of actually how the colors interpenetrate here. So that's essentially what we did. I don't need for you to read all of this, but we spent over a decade writing software that actually not only solves all these equations, it solves them in a very adaptive manner. So where you can actually zoom in, our sun came from a place where it used to be a trillion times larger than it is now. Stars are tiny, right? They're just so absurdly small compared to the galaxies they live in. The key thing for us is have techniques where we can follow this entire story of how all these different parcels of gas under the influence of gravity and being pushed around by each other manage to settle down to make an individual object like a star. And that's where just a lot of the work went into to get these equations implemented and then do it in a way where the computer itself can decide, ooh, that's where something interesting happens, right? It automatically follows the solution at higher and higher fidelity in these interesting regions. And so now all I'm going to do is just show you a few animations that sort of highlight the types of results that we obtained using these computer simulations. And the first thing I want to show you is what we call the cosmic web, is really the background that is formed by this mysterious dark matter collapsing under its own gravity. There's more of it than regular matter, so it forms quicker. And what we're doing in this movie, we're flying, our eyes going apart as the universe is expanding. So we don't see all the rushing out. Universe itself is getting bigger. But we see the relative motions. And what you notice, all this web-like structure, and that's a real feature of gravity. When you have an ellipsoidal thing, it's a bit longer in one direction, there's a three axis to it, it's the shorter one that will contract first. Gravity will win there, it doesn't have to fall as far, so it'll make a sheet, sort of a little round thing, a pancake. When the next axis collapses, you get more a cigar-like shape, a long cylindrical thing, that's sort of what we call filaments. When the third axis collapses, you get these round things. You call them halos, but that's the stuff that surrounds the Milky Way. Stars form within these round things where dark matter has collapsed from all different directions. And so we spend a lot of time looking at exactly this density field and all of the dense spots of dark matter is where all the galaxies form. Okay. Now the crucial bit for the motivation for us was as we looked at the very first object that formed, we just didn't know because we couldn't calculate before we had these computer simulations, would we make a whole bunch of stars, maybe like the globular clusters here, or would we end up making a whole bunch of black holes? And we had everything described in the literature about this. And essentially what we found is, in fact, let me skip this one, what we did find that is massive stars. It's actually individual massive stars that get formed right at the beginning. And that explained to us is why we never found one that has the same makeup as the gas that came from the Big Bang itself. Because all the early stars already exploded in supernovae, and they provided carbon, oxygen, all this stuff that we later use very well in our own bodies. And so here we just sort of see the individual stars forming, the radiation rushing out, lighting up the gas around it, and eventually the stars dying in supernovae explosions. Okay. So now I was a little bit too excited at the beginning, so I don't have quite time for all the animations. I would like to encourage you, though, if you're on a phone, if you get this link, 9GGB8B, it's really fun to look at your phone. because it's a 360-degree view, so it really feels like you're inside of it. And it also moves in time. So what the animation shows is the first billion years of cosmic history. And you see how the gas gets transformed from very opaque to a transparent gas. And all the yellow dots in here are the galaxies that provide the ultraviolet radiation that changes the makeup, that changes all the gas between the galaxies from being neutral hydrogen into ionized hydrogen. Okay, so now there's perhaps one crucial point I want to make before I finish. Sorry, there's a slow slide on this one. Come on. Point that I want to sort of take this. It's really perfectly fine to take the universe very personal. There is this aspect of it where if you think about a huge number of the atoms in your body are 13.8 billion years old. They were really there from the Big Bang. They were made in the first few minutes. And that's all the hydrogen that we have in our water, you know, that makes up so much of the mass of our body. But by number, obviously, there's tons and tons of hydrogen atoms. There's almost nothing that's younger than 4.5 billion years in your body. So I keep joking with my students about maturity and all of that. Even sort of a single bit of our fingers were just part of this very first generation of stars. So even what we have inside of us was already directly connected to the first thing that even formed in the universe. And the other part that really surprised me as sort of studying this and going through this is that there is an enormous number of stars that contributed to provide the elements that we have in our body. For some reason, when I first thought of this question of how many stars are inside of me or contributed to the elements inside of me, I was sure the answer was 3. Okay, I just had really not thought about it, but somehow I had an opinion about it already. But then as I started thinking a lot more about it, there's the region out of which the Milky Way galaxy formed is actually a few million light years across. So that place where we are now, all these processes of massive stars forming, blowing out, expelling gas, pushing things around, all of them happen in that region. And now mixing of this material is so rapid that I'm quite convinced that about the billion massive stars or so that were in that region that had already died or at least expelled some of their material before the sun formed ended up inside of us. So that was quite of a surprise, which also is sort of a joke about diet in a way. It used to be over a million light years across, and true for every single one of us. Yeah, so just leave you with a quick summary. Physics of the universe and how we sort of think about it, it's not just telescopes, it's also supercomputers that enable us to gain an intuition and understand how these processes work together to create all the structures around us and sort of provide all the necessary ingredients of all the things we cherish here. And yes, please do take this personal. Thank you.